And we are back. Welcome back to the Kings Report this Monday, 9/11, folks, 2017. I'm your host, Sean Moon, saying King of Chanyugug, and here we're broadcasting live to all the kings and queens of the kingdom. Make sure you stand in your kingship, folks. Christ said we are to be co-heirs with Christ in the kingdom. And it's important to understand your sovereignty. The book of Revelation says, let no man take your crown. The crown represents sovereignty, represents freedom. Your crown and your guns, you must never give them up because they represent the kingdom and the inheritance of the kingdoms of this world that are brought to subjugation and submission under the kingdom of God. So stand in your position as kings and queens. Don't let the devil take that from you. Here we are today, we are joined with Patriot John Zangardo. He is the founder of Operation Constitution. I'm sorry, did I butcher your name?
It's okay, I'm used to it.
2012 through current Constitutional Educational Group, Schuylkill County Leader, Liberty Caucus 2017, current District Director, Schuylkill County Jobs Development Initiative 2016 to current, Citizens Volunteer Outreach to assist in bringing better careers to the area. Also put together a legislative group looking to write common sense legislation, no more than 1 to 3 pages, easy to read and understand. John is also a veteran who was stationed in Korea and also served in Iraq. John, such an honor to have you this morning. Thank you for joining us, brother.
The honor and pleasure is completely mine. May I say to the crowd that's listening, God bless you all, and thank you for being here.
Well, we're so grateful, you know, to be speaking with a patriot like you yourself. Tell us a little bit about Operation Constitution and its mission.
Well, if I may first, my first and foremost blessing and my highest priority is I'm also a husband of one and a father of six. So I believe that is... That should always be our main focus, goal, and priority. Yes. And if we look close enough into our homes and houses, into our hearts, our families, those loved ones, we can seek a reason and find it to thrive for liberty. Now, from that is the reason why I went from being someone who watched all sports, loved sports, but it aggravated me that I could go to any of these bars and I could meet people who knew the stats from the Yankees 1930s lineup, knew the names, the batting averages, and everything. But they couldn't tell me who the current vice president or current attorney general was. They couldn't tell me what their Bill of Rights were. So from there, yes, I went ahead and developed just a simple little beta Facebook page, trying to educate people. And I strictly kept it along the lines of legislation that the White House was trying to put through and people's constitutional rights. Well, little by little, that developed into, I was teaching a 3-hour course once a month, which it was everything engulfed. It was world history to American history, to current events, to economics, both micro and macro, it was very much faith-based. My pastor actually helped me start that. We started off with pledge. We started off with a prayer, a little Bible verse reading. He was the foundation that allowed for us to have a platform of God first. Mm. And then from there, we went ahead and developed this educational system. Little by little, it grew bigger than myself. I developed a website from it. I never thought I could do that. I mean, if you'd asked me even 2 years before I started doing it, I could have told you, I don't have the ability, I don't have the skills, I don't have the time, I don't have the money. I did that, plus taught the 3-hour course once a month, came up with my own curriculum, went ahead and pushed to write for certain newspapers and online elements. I went out and found all these patriot groups. I pushed to find as many liberal groups as I could to show up to. Those were my favorite.
Wow.
And little by little, it developed what is now Operation Constitution. Operation Constitution was an idea that people want to know information, and they're tired of trying to seek it, going to Google, Bing, Firefox, search, what have you, and typing in something and then clicking on a bunch of different sites, trying and hoping to find the best information possible. Mm-hmm. So I developed it all onto one site. You can go there, click, and it's readily available. You want to know how to contact your congressman, whether it be your representative or your senator, the information's there. You want to know how to contact the Bureau of Land Management, the information's there. You want to know who's running for office, the information's there. You want to know what certain legislation is, there are certain direct links for that as well. There is direct access to so much information on there. It's ridiculous. We don't accept, it's not we don't ask, we don't accept donations from anybody. No monetary finances exchange hands whatsoever. It's all done out of my account directly. Should anyone want to help out, we ask people to do so by spreading the word, spreading the links. We don't spend any money in marketing. We try to keep it as grassroots as possible, and we've actually spread far and wide enough that nearly 300,000, 400,000 people have come to our site and taken notice to it, have taken information from it. Now, that sounds like a lot to some people, and other people says, oh, well, it's been around since 2012. That's not. Well, I think for every individual that's come to it, that's a success, because that's information shared and that's education for each individual.
Right. And it's not what they're getting either in the schools, the colleges, the mainstream media, the propaganda, Hollywood, Silicon Valley, you name it. And you're giving them really information that is educating them about their reality and these people who can change their reality by making laws, et cetera. I mean, how important is that?
Absolutely. And again, you brought up that I put together a team of people helping me write legislation, common sense legislation. I didn't do anything spectacular. I'm not a superhero. I'm not someone with a law degree or someone with a master's or a doctorate in anything. What I did is I got to know really, really decent people who were really good at one particular thing or another. And I put them all into a room together and said, hey, let's make something happen here. And we just got down, dug our nails in, and didn't give up. And honestly, our first piece of legislation we knocked out in about 6 weeks. We thought it was going to take roughly a year. It took us 6 weeks to come up with a one-page piece of legislation, common sense. Everyone understands the sunset law. Well, we kind of redeveloped it, and we rebranded it, and it's just a one-page simplification that holds the legislative branch feet to the fire. Basically, it says that every 2 years, tax, all state tax, has come up for a vote. In order for it to stay on the books, they must vote for it to do so. And if they do not, or if they miss that date, it immediately and automatically comes off the books from that very moment. Now, does it necessarily change anything? No, it may not. All those taxes could potentially stay on the books. It's not necessarily meant to get rid of taxes per se. It's meant to hold them accountable to we the people as to why those taxes are on the books. If we look back and we find all the different elements of taxation that we are being mandated to pay, Well, a lot of us will realize the majority of that was supposed to be only for a short amount of time, like the Johnsonville floods and so on and so forth here in Pennsylvania. Now, why are they still on the books? Well, that's for everyone to pay attention to. Okay, now that these come up for a vote every 2 years, that holds both the representatives and the Senate's feet to the fire. And should they go ahead and try to reinitiate it, reconstitute it, keep it in the loop? Well, now they have to answer for that. There's a yes vote behind each one of those taxes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Interesting. So how do people get involved in expanding sovereignty and pushing back against the big government, on steroids, both pushed by the military-industrial complex and the welfare state, warfare and welfare state? I mean, isn't that the real trope and technique of the international bankers, to get a state so centralized that it's either a warfare or welfare state? Because either way, they're going to make money off of it.
Well, let's go ahead and slow down and let's take a step back and look at what people can do without overwhelming their schedule, without taking them away from their family too much, without someone having to take a lot of time and study. Let's go back to the local things that people can do. Excuse me. You can literally take 5 to 10 minutes a day and change that local area immensely. Mm. 5 to 10 minutes a day. All you have to do is go to your council meetings, whether they be borough, city, town, what have you. Go to those. It's once a month. Go to your school board meetings. Again, once a month. Then, when there is a candidate that may not have the name recognition, may not have the money, but has the message that is right, you take that 5 to 10 minutes a day, and you either make phone calls for them, you knock on the doors, go to the bar, but talk about them. Wear a t-shirt. Go out and make your own t-shirt. They might not have the funds to have t-shirts and bumper stickers made. Go out and make your own. What harm is it for you to put your support behind the right candidate rather than the quote unquote popular candidate?
Yes, or even run yourself, right?
Me? Yes, I plan on running for state rep against a gentleman whose father was in office, then his father's good buddy was in office until they handed it down to him. And
wow.
I'm not going to demonize him. I'm not going to say he's a terrible human being. I'm not going to make him out to be some gremlin, but he's an empty suit who is not doing what he needs to do for the local communities. He's not being held to the flame, as it were. He's not doing his duties. This was never meant to be a leadership role. I'm so tired of hearing, well, I have the leadership ability that you need in this position. No. No, I don't care if you're the president of the United States. You're not my leader. You are a servant to this country.
Yes, public servant.
Either you are a local servant or a national servant. You might hold the greatest servitude office in public servant there is, which is the president. Okay,
yes.
Wonderful.
Public but employee.
You must understand that. You're a servant of both the constitutional laws and the rights of we the people. Sometimes we the people might scream out and beg for something, but if it is not within the constitutional confines of your position, it is not for you to go out and make it so.
Yes. I mean,
like a good parent, sometimes the best thing you can do is say no.
I mean, look at all this overreach, right? All these politicians, not only the politicians, but them doing so much illegal activity. Hillary Clinton with the 36,000 emails, her colluding with under the the Clinton Foundation, you know, embezzling 93% of the funds that she raised for Haitian victims. I mean, this has become standard operating procedure in Washington, and Washington has the ability to overrule, literally use the Constitution as tissue paper. Obama was using it as toilet paper, literally going against every single amendment, everything on states' rights, just laughing at it. I mean,
First of all, I can't rightfully attack Obama without looking at each and every individual that's been in office since Woodrow Wilson himself.
Right.
Every one of them has just scoffed at it. I don't care if they're Republican or Democrat. People want to sit there and put Reagan on a pedestal, but down JFK, well, you're not looking at them hard enough. They were basically the same person. They did the same things in office. You want to sit there and say that such and such was the greatest president in the past 100 years. The only one I can think of that could receive that title is Calvin Coolidge. People want to talk about the hard calls to make. You want to talk about current events initially and how it is engulfing us. Well, we have these hurricanes. Well, back during Grover Cleveland's time, there was, I don't remember, it may have been a flood or a drought down in Texas that they wanted $1 million to pay for it. Grover Cleveland said no. Once it goes on the books, I mean, I'm paraphrasing here, but once it goes on the books, it's most likely never going to come off. He understood that.
Right.
And he put his foot down like a stern parent and told the child no. You know what they did in Texas? They turned around and sought out local monies for charities and what have you, and more than doubled that amount. It's because the funds that are stolen through our hard-earned tax money that are mandated by the government, 17 to 30% of that goes to where they claim it is. Why? Because it has all these dirty funnels that it has to pass through, all these hands, bureaucracy, red tape. Whereas if you give it to a charity, you can watch where that dollar goes. You can hold them accountable. You can't do that with the Fed. You can't do that with the federal government. You cannot hold a government that is this vast and this large accountable like you can a private entity where you're donating your funds. You give your funds through donation. They say that anywhere between 70 to 98% through certain charities make it directly to the hands of where you're trying to put it. Now, you tell me. We'll go off averages, high average, 30% for the federal government's theft of your hard-earned funds being mandated and funneled through slush fund upon slush fund. Or we'll go low end, 70% of all monies donated through charity making it.
It's a no-brainer.
I think so. You have people like a gentleman that I was told you had on earlier, Daniel Johnson. Terrific young man that I think has been doing just this, trying to educate people about what the civil community's powers are and how to go about taking back that from the government so that the common sense finances can make it to where it needs to go. Do you realize all that slush fund ends up making it to, like you pointed out, the military-industrial complex? A lot of it does. Why? Because you'll have these companies, these Black Hawk, Allied Barton, just different companies out there that'll start up secondary companies, shell corporations, what have you, that'll funnel that money in during these hard times. I mean, Rahm Emanuel said, you never let a crisis go to waste. And companies and corporations do not allow any crisis to go to waste. Since the Korean War, we've had nothing but perpetual war. Why? Because the funds are good for them. And out of that funding builds fear for each individual so that we keep pushing for those funds to stay liquid for them. And out of that, they become rich. We become our rights. And what do they win out of it? Money. They don't even win freedom. They win money.
Right, 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 right. Now stay on that thought. We're going to be right back after the short break with more with John Zangardo breaking down all these current events and
inner workings of the big government. Stay with us.
Car Arms, Magnum Research, and Auto Ordnance. The Car Firearms Group. With a diverse product line that blends American craftsmanship with cutting-edge technology, it's no secret why gun enthusiasts choose Car Firearms Group. From the Desert Eagle and Baby Desert Eagle made famous by Hollywood, the history of the 1911 and the Tommy Gun, to the best in compact concealed carry. Car Firearms Group is not only the first name in personal defense, it's a name that has earned the respect of gun enthusiasts around the world. Concealment, innovative technology, value, accuracy, and history. Car Firearms Group, made in the USA. Visit car.com today.
Back, welcome back. September 11th, 2017, folks. Wow, what a what a day! What a day it is! A day that changed the 21st century and, of course, American history. 9/11. That is the day we are on. We're here with joined with John Zangardo, founder of Operation Constitution, patriot, veteran. John, can you break down, we were just talking about during the break, a little more deeply so that our audience can understand that?
Well, excuse me, I have a sinus infection, I apologize. People want to sit there and point fingers and blame to the head of our country's government, which is the president. People like to always find somebody out in the limelight that they can point their finger at. I'm not that kind of person. I want to look deeper. Usually if there's something on the surface of your skin, there's an infection below that is causing it.
Yes, yes.
Now, what it is we have 17 intelligence agencies that we know of that have been explained to the public that are currently working. I don't know about you, but if I put two antiviruses on my computer, they compete so much that my computer shuts down. So I can imagine trying to have 17 of them on there.
That's a beautiful analogy, isn't it? Nice analogy.
Sometimes there is such thing as too much security.
Yes.
And our founders understood that. After all, I mean, Ben Franklin himself came out and told, lady, we give you a republic now if you can keep it. That wasn't just a simplified quote that sounded neat. He meant it. He meant that liberty is like a flame in the midst of a tornado, you have to guard it. You cannot expect the government to do everything for you. You have to hold liberty high. You have to be careful.
It's always security, security, security. Help us grow the government. Give us more power. We're going to keep you safe. We'll keep you safe. More wars, more wars. Yay.
We're looking to pay certain gangs over in California right now, trying to keep them down. Why? What does that do for us? Haven't we learned from Pakistan and Iran and so forth that doesn't work? Now, what it is we have all these different agencies that are working not necessarily against our enemies. Raise your hand if you know who our enemies are. Why? Because NBC, CNN, and Fox News tells you?
Funding and arming the moderate Syrian rebels who are part of ISIS. Completely colluding. I mean, you have McCain out there dealing with ISIS and saying they're good guys. This is insanity.
Yeah. And so now that we've seen that, we were the reason that we ultimately put Fidel Castro into power. We ultimately put Saddam Hussein into power. We ultimately put Gaddafi into power. We have put all these people into the seats of power that they hold. When are we going to realize, like Rand Paul says, and I'm not someone who says, oh, well, we can't do things to help other countries. I'm not that sort of person. I believe that there are certain things that we can do to help other countries. But again, it comes through volunteerism. You know, there's other ways aside from our government mandating it. But like Rand Paul says, we need to stop with all this fear-mongering. Stop with all this foreign aid to our enemies, to people who burn our flags and scream death to America. But it doesn't necessarily mean that we need boots on the ground kicking in doors of civilians over there trying to, you know, start wars, trying to make a war for the next generation. I don't know about you, but I look at my children and I see something fragile that I just want to protect. And by that, by God, I don't want a war for them.
We were told
the ugliness of warfare.
Oh my goodness, we were told, and if you could comment on this, we were told over and over and over again, we're going into bringing democracy to the Middle Eastern countries. We're coming. Their democracy is always leads to totalitarianism and oligarchy. Yeah. And it just leads to the Muslim Brotherhood expanding, ISIS expanding. It's led to the opposite effect that we were promised. That's why this country was a republic, not a democracy.
Well, and it ultimately came so easily because of a corrupt media. A media that is in bed with the military-industrial complex that allows for these things to be perpetrated on each and every individual's TV. The interwebs is just full of it. Facebook actually is in bed with NSA and I'm sure other agencies, and they're open about it.
Oh yeah.
So I mean, when you realize this, you're being inundated. Now the military has a word for it. It's called PSYOPs. It's an actual position you can hold. It's called psychological operations. All it is marketing against the individual person to make them afraid in such a way that they just more or less become a zombie and do as they're told. Now, you might think, oh, well, not me. I'm too smart. Well, if you don't know what's happening, how do you combat it?
Right.
If you can't admit to yourself for one reason or another that you are, in fact, considered an enemy of the state by your own government. I mean, look at Panda. People against the NDAA, there's a reason for that. Because your government has declared war on you. All you have to do is look at the NDAA. You, every person listening to my voice, are considered a terrorist to your government. Your Bill of Rights has been lit on fire by your federal government itself. Go ahead. Don't take my word for it. By all means, like the Bible says, look into it for yourself. Seek truth. Never stop seeking truth. I don't care if it's biblical or legislative. Never stop seeking truth.
I mean, what a dangerous state of affairs. We're talking about the NDAA. We're at a point where you can be literally disappeared by the federal government and no due process, nothing. They can drone strike you, attack you, just disappear you. And there's no recourse. There's no way to keep them accountable. I mean, other than what you're doing is going to the local.
And the worst part is that the government has the ability to make each and every individual look the part of a terrorist. They can sit there and manipulate any sort of media. They can press charges against you that are false. They can falsify any document and report. They can go in and manipulate your website browsers to come up with anything that they want that will sway the public to dismiss you.
Yes, yes.
And once they can put stuff on your computer,
like with honey traps, Operation Honey Trap. They can literally take control of your computer, put child pornography on there, and then say, look, he's watching child porn. They can do all those kind of subterfuge activities.
Absolutely. And that is what your 17 known agencies of intelligence agencies, that is part of what they are doing right now. They are finding individuals that are pushing for liberty and finding them as threats to their growth in government, and they are attacking them with your tax money. We have agencies that should never, never exist here in American civilized community, like your IRS, your BLM, and so on and so forth. Rush Limbaugh. Yeah. I absolutely love the man. I don't care how you guys feel about him, but he was like an extra father to me. Him and Paul Harvey, I grew up with. Absolutely love them both. But Rush Limbaugh stated, you always hear the word American exceptionalism. Now, it's not because necessarily America is exceptional, which we are, but it's because we are the exception to the rule.
Yes.
Never before in the history of the world had it been tried, this amount of liberty given to the individual person. Every nation since the beginning of time, you had to go and beg some ruler for the right to do something. But here in America, it was granted that you and I, everyone listening to the sound of my voice, you were given the right to do something until you were told you cannot by your government. The government did not grant you the right. They restricted the right.
Yeah.
We were the exception to the rule. We held the trump card, if it were. We were the individual powers. Look at your 10th Amendment. It says everything not granted to the government on the federal level has been granted to you.
Yeah.
You have the rights.
Now, how about
you? Stand up and take it back.
Now, expanding on that, we know that the Protestant Reformation, freedom of religion, and this decentralized form of Christ-centered living, which is not centralized or state-run Constantinian sort of, Catholic Christianity, state-run Christianity, but a decentralized form of Christianity where we could go to the Bible ourselves, we could talk to our Creator ourselves, have a relationship with Jesus Christ ourselves, we could have a deeper understanding
which
of
if I may,
yes.
If I may, even he gave each and every one of us free will. So
yes.
Who's the government?
I mean, that's the root, isn't it?
Whenever Nebuchadnezzar himself, it wasn't Nebuchadnezzar, but whenever during Daniel's time, whenever the ruler went ahead and signed in the law that no one shall give praise to anyone but himself for that one day, even Daniel said, I don't think so, dude. I don't care what kind of government or how high up you are. That's wrong. And I will not follow that. So,
yes.
Why are we so cowardly now that we'll just, like ostriches, shove our head in the sand? God expects us to stand up against evil. We are to be angry but not sin.
Yes, yes, yes.
Be angry.
And to stand up against unrighteousness.
Better believe it. It is time for each and every one of us to stand for and stand strong. He didn't see Martin Luther King Jr. As Reverend cower from the fear of what was coming toward. He knew that the dangers were there.
Yes.
He knew that they would be attacked. But by God, he stood strong. We had the founders that all signed our Declaration of Independence, and John Hancock went ahead and made his name large and proud. Most of those people, after the war was over, was still hung, beheaded, nailed to crosses even. They were burned. They were shot. Their towns were pillaged after the war. They knew it was coming. But
yes,
they stood strong and understood that the generations after them needed a patriot, someone who was not brave. It wasn't bravery. They weren't without fear. They stood strong in faith, knowing it was the right thing, no matter what the outcome.
Yes, and that's really the core. I mean, look at this anti-Christian agenda pushed by the left. Now they have video games. What was that? What was the name of the video game that had?
I can't even say it was the left. Because, like you mentioned before, John McCain and the other rhinos, they're allowing it to occur. If you're not standing against it, you're allowing for it.
Yes, yes. I mean, they have
if you're sitting there quietly in your pew, thinking, I'll say my prayer and do my part and pray on Sunday in the pew. Hey, that's wonderful. We need everybody to do that.
Yes, and that's but like the body of Christ.
We need
to stay funded.
We need the Black Robe Society to stand up and bring the congregations forth once again to stand strong in their faith and say, this is wrong.
I mean, when is enough, you know? When will the body of Christ stand and say, no, we don't want the transgender agenda put rammed down our throat. Nope, we don't want the homosexual political agenda rammed down our throat. Nope, we don't care if you call us.
Oh, wait. You want to bring up the homosexual agenda. Now, we had civil unions. Now, certain civil unions in states were not as expansive as others. But what if they went ahead and just made a federalized civil union? Never went ahead and overstepped onto marriage, which then overtakes the Christian rights. If they just, and whether it's right or wrong, kept it government to government and faith to faith. If they went ahead and federalized the civil unions and expanded it as great and vast as the marriages are, but never overstepped onto the religious bounds, would there really be such disgust from the religious community? I don't think so, because you wouldn't have these shop owners that are losing their
job. Right. They don't want to bring a cake.
Okay. Yeah. And these pastors that don't want to marry them, which
right.
Back in the early 1800s, the government didn't even have the right to partake in marriages, only divorces.
But meanwhile, if you're Muslim and you behead gays, that's fine. That's liberal and that's trendy.
but the government begged the church for the right for them to be able to perform marriages, because they said children were property and they believed that they should go ahead and have such right. And the church gave just a little. And like the saying goes, where an inch is given, a mile is taken.
It's like the garden. God gave Adam and Eve, humanity, the blessing of be fruitful, multiply, have dominion over the earth. He didn't give it to the archangel, even though the archangel was powerful and helped him in creating all this kind of thing. He gave it to his children. And you got the archangel always coming in, trying to break up marriage, trying to break up relationship, trying to break up relationship with God, trying to break up our sovereignty, break up our dominion, all that, and trying to steal it for himself. And my father that's why we call it political Satanism, this big government, political Satanism, because it creates the environment for real Satanism to flourish.
Yeah, it never happens with a quick, harsh, in-your-face movement. It generally occurs with a whisper in the ear and a moment of weakness, and then little by little that fire spreads and overtakes.
The totalitarian tiptoe, as Dan Johnson, I think, calls it.
You got to love Mr. Johnson. I mean, such a young man. Has so much potential. Oh,
wow. He's amazing. He's amazing.
You have a lot, if I may. I'd like to say thank you to so many Patriots out there, like Daniel Johnson, like Lou Jezikoff. There's a young woman in the southern parts of Pennsylvania, Donnelly Merritt, she is just on fire for the people. And you have so many good Patriots out there that are doing so many wonderful things. You have Dale Kearns, who's running for Senate on Libertarian ticket. I can't say who's going to win or who's going to be in office, but I know that his heart's in the right place and he's wanting to bring liberty to people. You have people who are running on Republican ticket, like Rick Saccone, who's actually running against Dale Kearns, who, again, I think is another wonderful and terrific person. You have a lot of really, really good people with righteous faith in their heart that is trying to do the right thing. You have Andy Olszkowski. I'm pretty sure I just butchered his name, but he is just wanting to bring us back to the Bill of Rights. You have so many people out there running for office, and some of them for the same office. So you have a lot of really, really decent people out there if you just pay attention. And like I said, don't wait for them to take the steps. Go out and make your own t-shirt. Make your own bumper sticker. Go out and knock on some doors. Go to a bar and just sit down and talk to people casually. Why do you know the stats of your sports team, but you don't know the policies and legislation that's trying to be passed? It's your rights, your liberty, your money, your children's future.
Wow. John Zangardo, amazing patriot, founder of Operation Constitution. Let everybody know how they can get in touch with you or how to support you. And, of course, any other websites or social media that you may have.
I'm on LinkedIn, Facebook, and if you go to operationconstitution.org, if you're on a mobile device, you can actually just hit the call button and it calls me directly to my cell phone.
Wow, that's great. Thank you so much, John, for joining us this morning. Tremendous words of wisdom coming from a man who's lived it, been in Iraq, stepped on the battlefield for this country, and is still on the battleground here as the United States of America are under threat by enemy forces within our own nation.
We need more young people and patriots, old and young alike, to stand up against this type of wickedness. John, thank you so much for joining us this morning, and it's great to hear you and talk to you again.
We all may, whatever point of time of day or night, take a moment and don't forget the people lost in 9/11. It doesn't matter if you believe it's some sort of conspiracy theory or it is what the news tells you it is. It's not about that. It's about the people we lost and the families who lost their loved ones. Take a moment and say a prayer to them.
Amen to that. Thank you, John. Thanks so much, brother.
Thank you.
Great to talk to you.
God bless.
Talk to you soon. Thank you.
And that was John Zangardo, folks. Wonderful young man who hopefully can run for state rep. That would be great to have him as state rep. What a patriot. A man who is totally awake. A man who's standing up and doing what he can on a local level. And that really is the key to get our communities activated at the local level and start taking over with ideas and with sovereignty and liberty and the God-given rights that are protected by the Constitution. So important, get to the local level. We got to start volunteering, get our kids activated. Our kids are very aware, politically awake, but also they have to realize, wow, they can be the next commissioner. They can be the next city councilman. They can be the next person on the board that can block federal overreach. All those kind of things can happen, but we have to get activated and empower our people to step up, to stop seeing themselves as just, you know, slaves of these established politicians, but go in there, take it over, and bring it back to sovereignty. We'll be right back after the short break. Stay with us on the King's Report.
Hold on, Lord ain't finished yet. Hold on, hold on, he'll get you through this. Hold on, hold on, these are the promises I never will forget, I never will forget. So hold on, hold on, the Lord ain't finished yet. Hold on, hold on, he'll get you through this. Hold on, hold on, these are the promises I never will forget, I never will forget. I know your heart been broke again. I know your prayers ain't been answered yet.